When I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How
good morning and welcome to this time of celebration of life of Robert Earl Gordon. And indeed it is a celebration because we know where he is. This is just a temporary right here, we're reminded, but he is in the very presence of his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and he is rejoicing seeing him face to face. And that's the hope that we have. It's a blessed assurance to know that Jesus is ours. And as the scripture says, to be absent from the body is to be present indeed with the Lord. So thank you for your presence here today to encourage the family. Also, it's a time of seeking the Lord ourselves and acknowledging him in all of our ways and allowing the Lord to speak to us. So we want to begin with scripture and prayer and some comments. So as we do, think on these words and we'll pray in just a moment. Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall laud your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. The might of your awesome deeds shall be proclaimed, and I will declare your greatness. They shall celebrate the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and His compassion is over all that He has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your faithful shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to all people your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all of His words and gracious in all of His deeds. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season, to open your hand, satisfying the desire of every living thing. The Lord is just in all His ways and kind in all His doings. The Lord is near to all who call upon Him, to all who call upon Him in truth. He fulfills the desire of all who fear Him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love Him, but all the wicked He will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless His holy name forever and ever. Let's bow together as we pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank You that we can share together this day in Your presence, and we celebrate the wonderful life of Robert Earl Gordon. And thank You for the family and friends that are here. And we know to be in Christ that all of us are family. And in fact, we're blood kin through the blood of Jesus Christ. We pray today that You will minister to the exact needs of each one present. We know on one hand we grieve because we know that we no longer have Him here in our immediate presence. But at the same time, we can rejoice because there's no more suffering, pain, or sickness, or sorrow. He is fully alive in Your presence, for that we know assure, as You've promised us. So Lord, have Your way in this time as we seek Your face and as we listen to Your voice speaking to us through the Holy Spirit. And may Your name, Jesus, be exalted here as we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. When I think about Robert, I think about several qualities. And I want to contrast these and compare them, of course, with our Heavenly Father. We've read some scripture here just now to think about God as our Creator and how exalted He is, extolled He is. He's worthy of all our praise and all of our honor and all of our glory and singing to Him and living before Him. But you know, the same God who's Creator, having all power, who's ever present, all knowing, all wise, all around us, He's here right now in His Spirit, is the same one as the Word became flesh in the person of His Son, Jesus Christ. That is, He humbled Himself, left heaven's glory, took upon the form of a servant, a vicarious, a suffering servant, to die for you and for me, for our sin. In fact, Jesus became sin. The perfect Lamb of God took your sin and my sin and the sin of the whole world, and He paid the price one time. But now He has been raised up after dying on the cross, buried in a tomb that was borrowed. 3 days later, He arose from the dead, and then later He ascended to the Father, is now at the right hand, praying always for us. He's the great high priest. He knows our deepest needs, our sorrows, our pain. But I think also about Robert. He was a man that was very humble. He was a man who walked with the Lord, who knew Jesus, and never met a stranger. He had a great sense of comedy about him and made you feel at ease, down to earth, and just always was very personal to you, looking to you right in the eye, and a handshake, or good morning, or good afternoon. And so he was always there. So a very humble man. But also I think about the character of God. God is love. That's what the Scripture says. God is love. A very simple thing we can share, but so powerful. God is love. He demonstrated that by giving up His only Son. As for God, so loved the world, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. What awesome love our God has. You know, and once again, we think about Robert. What a love. I didn't know it till the other day, Sunday, as you told me, Ann, that y'all were sweethearts in the fifth grade. I thought, how wonderful, you know. I thought about Pastor Dennis, that he and his bride in kindergarten, you know, and well, there are pictures of them. But, you know, isn't that wonderful? How many maybe had sweethearts that you didn't know about early? I remember that I liked girls when they called them cooties, you know. And I didn't know what cooties were, but I had two older sisters, the only son, although I wanted one, but, you know. But anyway, it's wonderful because childhood, sweethearts, and then married at 20, and then 66 years. Wow. But you see, he loved you, and you know that. You loved each other. Loved your family, as we think of Alan, and we think of his wife, Pam. And he loved you, Melinda. His baby girl. So, yeah, he loved you. And Mark. Yeah. And Hope. And Cole. Love. What love. And love for all of us. You know, he made a relationship with so many. I think about the Sunday school class over here with, well, this row and a couple of rows and three rows and part of four rows. And I think I got far. There's some, I think, maybe further back, too, that didn't quite make it. I'm not quite sure because, but through the years, other Sunday school classes you talked about the other day, that they've just sort of all gone before us. All gone before us. But, you know, they, too, are probably looking down, maybe, if they have time. But they're just beholding the face of Jesus and rejoicing. I believe there's that great cloud of witnesses that are just cheering y'all on right now. Just saying, hold on, it's going to get better. So we can begin to celebrate. We can rejoice because we know the outcome. We're not losers. We're more than conquerors to those who love Jesus. We're victorious. In fact, the scripture says, whosoever is born of God overcomes this world. And this is a victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. You see, it's faith in God who is love. It's faith in God who humbled himself. It's faith in the God who is love. And it's wonderful to know that those who know him become like him. You see, he was an humble man. He was a loving man. And also, he was kind. He was kind to everybody. And I remember that kindness so much. Easy to be around, make you feel comfortable, laugh a bit, joke a little bit, and just tried to just be kind to everybody. That's the goodness of God, of kindness, you know. So we just rejoice. So, well, when we think about this in life, you know, there are times when we begin to have struggles and difficulties of all kind. And wow, did Robert have a lot of those, as you well know. He didn't complain. He was just stick-to-ing. He'd run the race. There were times it was heavy and hard, but cancer and three times and treatment. And but missed so much being at church. Y'all would always tune in and know he didn't need to go out because he needed to be careful about his health and catching something else and getting worse. But boy, did he keep on going and keep on going and keep on going. That routine of, and thankful for live stream and thankful for other means too. But you know, when we think about that, we think about the day of his departure. Because you know, when Jesus first invites us to him, he invites us really to come to a place of rest. Okay? He invites us to come to rest. The scripture says, come unto ye all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. And you know, that's more than just physical. We have our share of physical, emotional, and other burdens, but the greatest burden of all is our sin. And that's why Jesus invited people to come to him, so that he could bear their sin. And Robert did that. He came to know Jesus, and for many years walked with him and knew that he was right there with him through the physical tough times, the emotional times, the uncertain times of what's going on, but trusted his whole life to him. But you see, there's a place of quiet rest, and it's near to the heart of God. And when we cry out to the Lord, as we read a few moments ago, he hears those who call upon his name. His name is the Lord God Almighty. His name is Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. His name is Savior. His very name Jesus means Savior for our sins. So God's heart of love is perfect love. But until we come to know him, we really don't know what love is all about. But when we do, we grow in that fruit of the Spirit, love and joy and peace and on as we see in the scriptures. But you know, there we can celebrate today because on that day, his family had already begun to say bye. And as he began to quickly, from that morning and throughout that day, you know, you surrounding him with love, and you were going to miss him. You know it was coming soon. But you cried out for a prayer that would be answered, and it was. And that was mercy. See, God's a merciful God. And they wanted to ease out really quietly and at ease, and he was. The nurses were so good ministering to him. And you remember those. And it was a joy and privilege that God gave me just the right timing to come down there and to journey with you. And those last late afternoon hours of Sunday and early evening there, and to see that, you know, although he couldn't talk and he was very still upon the bed, he was not in pain. He was right there in the presence of the Lord with the family there, and Melinda had stepped out and, you know, for a little while and to do some things, but that was okay. She said, I think it probably didn't want me here anyway. That's not true necessarily, but we know he just knew, didn't he? He waited to say, I'm going to wait till she leaves. Daddy's girl. Well, what do we think about? You know, sometimes we call RIP rest in peace. Sometimes Jesus would say, they're not really dead, they're sleeping. Because, you know, there's no soul sleep for the believer. To be absent from the body is immediate to be in presence of the Lord. But you see, we have a struggle through life, and sometimes we're fighting so hard that we don't take time to rest in Christ. You see, the invitation is there at the beginning to, first of all, rest by coming to know Jesus as Lord and Savior and turning from our sin and placing our faith in Him. Secondly, it is just simply day by day by day abiding Him, living in a love relationship of God who is love. And that's why there was love in His family, because of what a legacy this is of love. But also to simply keep the focus of how to walk with Jesus through life is loving Him first. The great commandment. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. I didn't know today, but found out our neighbors are the family, and we're so thankful to find that out. But, yeah, then also, you see, if we will trust the Lord and take His yoke upon us, that's the key to work. You see, we think about oxen that are yoked together, that strength, because without Him we can do nothing. You see, we can't even go through life with all the difficulties, but with Him, oh, we have His strength, and He's all powerful. So all we have to do is call on His name for anything. And are we in need? My God supplies all your need according to His riches in glory through Christ Jesus. You see, so we come to a place of learning what Lord Sabaoth is, the Sabbath, the Lord our rest. So have you found a resting place? Have you come near to the heart of God by calling on Him? Have you, through your life, as you journey with Him and grow more in His likeness, to learn to listen to His voice? It reminds us, come now, abide with me. Let's go apart for a while and rest. That's why God made the days short and the night, to remind us we need to rest these bodies. Yeah. We need to rest the emotions. But you know, whether it's dark, whether it's daylight, the true rest is found in Jesus, the light of the world, the one who is near to us. So cast all your cares upon Him. Every burden, every sorrow, you'll be crying, you'll be weeping, you'll be laughing, you'll be all kinds of emotions. But do know, the Lord has promised, I will never leave you or forsake you. I'm your good shepherd. I'm your good father. And all you have to do is have a little talk with Jesus and tell Him about His troubles. But you know, when the roll is called up yonder, I'm going to be there. I hope you are. And you're going to enjoy this next one. You see, the Lamb's Book of Life has all those that will be with Him forever. And there will be a roll call, and everybody's going to be there, because it's going to be 100%. No more sickness, no more pain, no more death. 100% present. He's got just a head start, okay? All right. Blessings to you.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Thank you, Pastor Ken, and thank you for Johnny Cash for singing for us. In 1964, I had two older sisters and one younger sister, so I got introduced to the oldies when they were goodies, and but still they ring in my mind. In 1964, Chad and Jeremy recorded a summer song, and there's a phrase I've always liked, this phrase, except for I have to be real careful with it. They say that all good things must end someday, autumn leaves must fall, but don't you know that it hurts me so to say goodbye to you? I wish I didn't have to go. And like I said, I find myself singing that song sometime, and I have to catch myself because I don't like that part that says they say that all good things must end someday. And of course, we're talking about the temporal must end, but the best is still yet to come. And those words remind us kind of a romantic time in our life that was sweet and rich and times of enjoyment. And we all have those kind of things. We're approaching Thanksgiving time. With that celebration time of Thanksgiving and then Christmas and the seasons and, you know, there's longing within our heart. My mom passed away 36 years ago. And so this will be Thanksgiving and Christmas number 37 that I spent without my mom. It's just hard to imagine that. And it really makes you think about the temporalness of this life. The message that I'm sharing today, and typically I really like to have a message that I've never used before, never preached before. But this is one of those weird times. Never had a time like this before that Ann shared with me that Robert had a sermon that I had preached. I thought she first said just a few years ago. Well, it turns out to be a sermon that I preached on November the 25th, 2007. So I went back and thank the Lord, my computer, I had sermons in there back to 2007. Before that, I guess I wasn't using a computer. So I have this today to share with you, and it is exciting to me as I was looking over the notes. Because the title of the message is Celebrate God's Unchanging Nature. And the reason I opened up with the story about the song and about my mom is because we realize that this life is temporary. It's temporal. And when you think of it, it helps us understand that we are finite and God is infinite. Now, it wasn't originally intended to be that way. We were created to live forever in the creation that God had provided. But because of sin, death, and that death entered the scene, and really that death impacted everything. In fact, Paul writes in Romans 8 and says, all of creation is groaning for redemption, because even creation is, we know, it's not just death, but it's also decay. That entered the world. And this time of year, we're reminded we've got leaves falling everywhere. And we're reminded of that decay, but then we know when springtime comes, it'll crank up one more time. So I want to share with you about some of the disappointments that come with the temporal, but yet the great blessings that come with the eternal, because it's very important. The writer of Ecclesiastes says this. He says, let me ask you the question, how are we going to face these difficult times? Like today, no doubt a very difficult time. But the writer of Ecclesiastes says this. In Ecclesiastes 3:11, he says, "He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the hearts of men. Yet they cannot fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end." So I want to share 3 points with you about our limitations. And the first is this: realize that you have limitations. Realize that you have limitations. Now, I always like to use this because I remember my mom and dad, when I was little, they would say, "I am wore out." And I thought, I have no idea what in the world they're talking about. I do now. It's pretty common now that I come to the end of a long day and I say, "Man, I am wore out." I finally understand what that means, because these limitations become more apparent every time we live, every year we live. I still haven't played softball yet this year, but I still like to play softball. But I still, in my head, I'm playing like I'm 20. But then the next day, I feel like I'm 100 because I push myself thinking I can still do what my head tells me to do. But my body says, "No, boy, you can't either." And these limitations become apparent. And I had this really presented to me with a golden retriever that we had years ago, Zachy. And we put one of those invisible fences up, you know, and you put the little flags up in the yard. And that poor old dog, bless his heart, and I know this sounds cruel, but he would walk out to the end of the, near the flags, and he would stand there and he'd go, "Just back up, just move away." And I think he finally got it, that where those flags all represent my limit. I can't go any further than that. And you see, we have that. We have those limits. I was reminded of this morning, and that is, you know, there used to be a commercial, and I forgot what it was advertising, but it fits with brake shoes. And it talked about those parts, and this just the saying just drove me crazy. The parts that are designed to wear out. I mean, why would you design any part to wear out? Like brake shoes. I mean, why can't they come up with brake shoes that would last forever? But yet they're designed to wear out. And I guess it's so that the folks that put the brake shoes on can make money on that. So, Sean's that right? But when God created us, we were not designed to wear out. We were designed to live forever. But then sin entered the scene, and it literally, what we sang a Vacation Bible School song a few years ago, sin messed everything up. So first point is, realize that you have limitations. David wrote, he says, "My days are like the evening shadow. I wither away like grass." That's just that reminder that these bodies are limited and they're going away. Just facing our limitations brings frustration. You know, there's things you just can't do anymore. And that's extremely disappointing that we say, "I can't do what I used to do." Second point is, try to grasp God's unlimited nature. We have limitations. God has no limitations. God is not limited in any way. We cannot even fathom God. We try to, and Scripture gives us words, but words are designed for man. But yet still, we just can't wrap our minds around this and understand. So I say, try to grasp the unlimited nature of God, because we really can't. We can't grab a hold of all that. And which that helps us be reminded that there should always be this awe in our worship. God's not like us at all. He is eternal. And when you think of eternal, and I try to illustrate this on our stage before our folks, on a regular basis, there was a time before time, and then there's going to be a time after time. We only understand living in time, but you see, God is eternal on both sides of that. And so God knew everything before he created anything. He knew you before he formed you. And he had already provided a lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world to bring salvation to you so that we don't have to be living for eternity impacted by the temporary. God is bigger and greater than all that. The psalmist also wrote in Psalm 90, verses 1 and 2, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, you brought forth the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting. You are God. And again, fathoming that, we fathom it only by the existence of faith. Paul writes in Romans, he says, oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Who has known the mind of God or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him and through him and to him are all things. In Hebrews 11, we read the roll call of faith. By faith, Noah did this. By faith, Abraham did this. By faith, Moses. You see, what happened, that faith connected those people to the eternal God. It's amazing to me that God allowed the temporal human being to be connected to the eternal God. But he did that, and he did it by faith. You see, when we look back in the Old Testament, those folks were placing their faith in something God called them to do. Build an ark. Believe that God was going to provide children to them, although they were 90 and 100 years old. But God was going to provide, and he did. And so they linked the temporal human being to the eternal God. And see, I think this is a great sermon. I agree with Robert. I mean, heaven's sake. I mean, I started going back over it yesterday. I said, whoa, this is good. I don't know where this came from, but this is good. I surely didn't plagiarize somebody. You see, but Hebrews tells us this. It says, all these people were still living by faith when they died. Robert was still living by faith when he died. And the only thing he was anticipating is leaving the limitations and going into the unlimitations. Being greeted by the unlimited God who met him there in the person of Jesus and said, well done, good and faithful service. Goes on to say, they did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. They were living with and by faith, knowing that God would finish everything beautifully, even if they did not firsthand understand it and experience it. You see, this is something that God has incredibly done for us. He's given us faith. He's given us faith, and he's told us all about his nature in such a way that we become overwhelmed. Before I go to the third point, the last point, faith connects us to the unlimited God, the unlimited resources, the one that we are told in Scripture, nothing is impossible with God, nothing. I'm convinced, and I heard a dear brother, Jack Taylor, preach this years ago, that we should always, and we're told in Scripture, pray for healing. Pray for healing. And we say, well, but, no, ifs, ands, or buts. We're told to pray for healing. And if you're anybody sick, call for the elders to come and anoint and pray the prayer of healing, pray the prayer of faith. Listen, it's up to God. And you see, we hear doctors say, you know, you got 6 months to live. I've heard that happen to people, and they've still lived 20 years beyond that. Why? Because doctors are limited, and doctors are only going to tell you what they know and what they understand. But they are not infinite. They are finite. And that's not critical. That's just an understanding that they're giving you the best information that they have based on the information that they have, and their information is not unlimited. Where even the good life, best life, the good life as we know it, the best life, ends. Just like Chad and Jeremy's song, but that was about summer coming to an end, and I guess they're going to go back to school, and they were going to be brokenhearted until the next summer, perhaps, and the next flame. So we use faith to connect ourselves to God's unlimited nature. We started this a moment ago when I mentioned Hebrews 11. Now, faith is being sure of what you hope for and certain of what you do not see. We practice faith a lot of times in ways every day, just simple human faith in humanity. When you board an aircraft, I don't care how successful they've been for all these many years and how much it's safer to fly than it is to drive, but still you're exercising a tremendous amount of faith to get on an aircraft because you're believing that the pilot's going to do his job or her job and the mechanics have done their job and we're going to make it from point A to point B. But yet, faith that we're talking about here is being sure of the promises of God that are given to us. Where in Romans 5:20 it says, but where sin increased, grace increased all the more. So I'm headed down to the end of this, but I want to ask you, have you connected yourself to the unlimited nature of God? God's given us an open door to do that very thing. You see, when limits become a reality, 86 years, Robert Gordon reached his limit. Now, my poor golden retriever, when he reached his limit, it took him a while to realize, I don't want to go there anymore. But you see, when Robert reached his limit, he crossed over, never to come back over here again. No more pain, no more sorrow, no more death, no more tears. Just a rejoicing and anticipation of a glorious day of resurrection. When our limits become reality, then faith needs to connect us to God's reality, His infinitude. God has no limits. God has formed you. He has or desires to transform you so that you're not saying this is all there is. I've always been kind of watchful of commercials. Remember that old commercial that's a beer commercial? And the guys are out fishing, and they confess something. It doesn't get any better than this. Oh, heavens. Ooh, isn't that a terrible thought? That sitting out on a lake and drinking beer, and this is as good as it gets? Thank God that's just not true. Because I can tell you, if Robert Gordon could come and talk to you right now, he would say, listen, folks, it gets a heavenly lot better than this. Because I've been there, and I've seen the Lord. I've seen His presence. I've seen the glory and the beauty and the splendor of eternity. You see, God allows us to be translated and transformed and transferred. He does this in a great way. So here's what we know, okay? And unfortunately, everything I'm sharing with you, I know biblically by faith. In 1 Corinthians 13:12, Paul writes, now, in the temporal, in the limited, we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully as I am fully known. Do not let your limitations result in lamentation. Just realize that your limitations are a reminder that the best is yet to come. I am thankful. My dad lived to be 93, and I'm thankful for that. He lived with my sister the last few years of his life and then became bedridden because of an inoperable brain tumor. And my sister, as sweet as she was, she said, Daddy, she said, you can go. It's okay for you to go. And my sweet daddy looked at her and said, that's fine if I can take you with me. What a precious thing for my sister to have heard from my daddy's mouth saying, I need you. I love you. You have taken good care of me. So make the transfer connection. Make the transfer connection to God's unlimited nature. I know that we're all saying, Lord, I really like it here. It's really good. And you know why we like it here so much? Because it's all we know. Everything else we know beyond here is what we believe by faith and we trust and depend on. I've read and studied Randy Alcorn's book on heaven. If you've never read it, read it. Do like I did, mark it all up. Don't give it away. I gave my marked edition away, and I regret it, but that's life. But it becomes like a reference book that you go back and you read and you get reminded. Can you imagine this with me for a moment? What is it going to be like in eternity? Yeah, it's so good, so good. And I'm thankful for his writing, his ability, his biblical imagination, because we had this picture. Now, of course, I pastor Harps Crossing Baptist Church, and we all like to think that, or at least have been taught, that we're going to be sitting on clouds playing harps. Please, Lord, no, please. I got a feeling we're going to go get to see his creation in its perfection, its beauty and its splendor. And remember, like him, our limitations will be gone. And I believe we'll be able to go to outer space and see into the depths of the ocean and see. And also that we can look at creation and gawk at the greatness and magnitude of God. I mean, have you ever gone someplace, seen a beautiful experience of something God created, and you just stood there in awe? Well, folks, that would be eternity of praising the Lord and just saying, oh, God, how great, how wonderful you are. Robert Gordon experienced and is experiencing for eternity the victory that comes through Jesus Christ. What about you? What about you? I know sometimes you don't meet joyous Christians, but I happen to be one because I know the promises of God are absolutely true. And Robert Gordon went to his limitation and then passed over into the unlimited with his awesome God. How about you? Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for sweet, sweet, sweet time. Thank you for the privilege and honor of rejoicing and celebrating and being able to take those the desire that Robert Gordon had to preach this message that he enjoyed, and so the people could hear about Robert's faith and where he came from. It came from the unlimited God, you God. Thank you, Lord, for that. And I pray, Lord, that every person here today, if they've never prayed it, would pray a prayer like this that says, Dear God, I believe you sent Jesus so that I could connect this finite, limited nature to the infinite, unlimited nature of you and live forever in that eternal dwelling place. God, thank you so much for the victory that we have in Jesus. Just blood.